अस्सलाम वालेकुम।
वालेकुम सलाम जी, क्या हाल है आपके?
ठीक ठाक तैयार सब? आप ठीक हैं?
जी, 1 मिनट की तरफ
जी
एंटर।
जी
बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम एंड गुड मॉर्निंग, गुड आफ्टरनून एंड गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट्स ऑन जूम एंड फेसबुक एंड यूट्यूब। टुडे इज बीएससी लेक्चर नंबर 24 एंड आर Speaker is Professor Fuad Ahmed Najam, who is a teacher in NUST it is NUST Institute of Civil Engineering, which is abbreviated as NICE, N-I-C-E, where he is currently teaching. First, I apologize to all of you. Today I am not feeling well, and my throat is not supporting my voice very well. Kindly bear this problem with me. I would be here anyhow for the whole lecture, and I am assisted by Mrs. Sadia Naveed in the background. She is supporting me technically on the net and Zoom. If there are any problems, she will be assisting me in that. So, first, before I introduce the speaker to you, there are certain announcements, routine announcements. Gentlemen, you will have to keep your cameras always live, showing your face on the screen. As I have told you many times, that this is the requirement of Pakistan Engineering Council. You have to make sure that those who are the recipients of CPD certificates, they listen to the lecture. This is the foremost idea of this seminar, to impart education among our engineers, young engineers, experienced engineers. So this was the first announcement. Second, Dr. Saab, I want to ask you, would you prefer questions during the lecture, or they should ask the questions at the end of the lecture? We have a 20 minutes question answer session. So which way would you prefer?
I think, sir, the second option is more adequate, that the question answer session can be at the end.
Now everybody, let me admit four people. They are a bit late. Then I will make this announcement. Again, the video will remain open. Your face should be visible live. On the screen always, as per PEC regulation. Number two, the speaker has preferred that the questions should be asked at the end during the question answer session. In the meantime, whenever you have a question in your mind, kindly text it. I will note it, and at the end I will read the question for the speaker. So don't hesitate to write your questions whenever it comes to your mind. Just type it and I will note it. Second, and the third announcement is, as you know, this is the first lecture which is being charged for the non-associates. We are charging rupees 500 for each non-associate who is attending this lecture. But the lectures are still free for the associates. And this is to encourage you people to become the associate of the society. To become associate, very easy. Go to the website, fill in the form, and annual fee for associateship is rupees 1000. Whereas the society is it's conducting 12 lectures. Every month there is one lecture, and it is, if you are a member, it will be free of cost for you, 12 lectures at a price of 1000, which is a membership fee for associates. So these are the announcements which I had to make before the start of the lecture. One last announcement. Please keep your mics in a mute position so that there is no disturbance in the lecture. And kindly, I will again make the announcement. Keep your videos on. Your face should appear live on the screen. Don't. Now, Mr. Hassan Mumtaz, Junaid Ahmed Saab, you people are not alive. Safraz Sahab and Amir Sahab, please switch on your cameras, and you have to appear live. Otherwise, don't put in a difficult situation, and don't force me to make announcements again and again. This, you know, disturbs the flow of the speaker also. I don't want to make any announcements during when he starts his lecture. Kindly noted. Junaid Sahab, Safraz Sahab and Amir Sahab, please, and Mohammed Zubair Sahab also, please switch on your cameras. Thank you. So now I will start with the introduction of Dr. Fuad Ahmed Najam. He did his undergrads from UET Texla in August 2009 in civil engineering. Then he did his graduation from NUST Islamabad. Graduation means master's. He did his master's from NUST Islamabad in August 2011. Then, mashallah, he did his PhD from AIT Thailand in October 2017. He has an unblemished, excellent academic career. During his education, he has won a number of awards and scholarships. And if I announce those lists, it will take a lot of time. So it was very difficult for me to summarize his CV and introduction for you. It was such a long CV. Now, his practical experience is, currently he is an assistant professor, as I have told you, in NUST Institute of Civil Engineering, which is abbreviated as NICE, N-I-C-E. And he is here since 2017. Before that, he was a structural engineer at AIT Solutions, which is a subsidiary of AIT, or a constituent organization. And this assignment he was doing during his PhD from 2014 to 2017. And before that, he was a technical assistant in School of Civil and Environmental, which is again a part of AIT, from 2012 to 2014. He again, before that, he was a laboratory engineer in NICE from 2010 to 2011. He was a junior lecturer from 2009 to 2010 in Swedish College of Engineering and Technology in Pakistan. And before that, he was a course instructor in Department of Civil Engineering, UET Texla, from June 2009 to August 2009. Dr. Fawad has a special research interests. He is a research-oriented engineer, research-oriented person. He and the topics of his interests are structural dynamics, earthquake engineering, performance-based seismic assessment and design of structures, seismic hazard analysis, disaster resilience and vulnerability assessment, non-linear modeling of structures. He has done 16 assignments of research and consultancy, which were in the areas of seismic hazard analysis, finite elements and finite element analysis of 3D masonry structures for crack prediction. And then he did his topic of interest is structure performance based evaluations and disaster risk reduction of building. There are more topics of his interest. I just told you a few of them. To date, he has authored a book, Structural Cross Sections Analysis and Design. His book is Non-Linear Static Analysis Procedures for Seismic Performance Evaluation of Existing Building. This book has been authored by him. And then he has two books which he has co-authored, one with Najam F.A., one with Anwar M. It is Structural Cross-Sections Analysis and Design. And second one is with Mr. Sohail, that is Modeling and Analysis of Soil Pile Interaction for Dynamic Loading. So as an author and co-author, he has three books to his credit, which have been already published. He has 8 published journals and articles, and 3 are under review. 27 conferences are to his credit, where his co-authored papers have been read. And Dr. Saab is involved in public education also. He runs his own YouTube channel, and an educational website, which is www.structurespro.information, where he arranges some online classes. And on YouTube channel, he must be doing some educational services live for the students. If anybody is interested, they can contact Dr. Saab directly to know what he's doing on the YouTube channel. I'm pretty sure he's doing a very nice work there for the engineers. Then in the magazines and media related activities, he's also involved, where 9 articles have been already published. And in the news media also, he has been writing articles regarding engineering. Lastly, he has supervised several undergrad, graduate and PhD students in their thesis and projects. To date, he has supervised 5 PhD programs at NUST. 17 are ongoing in the NUST and 3 are ongoing in AIT, Asian Institute of Technology in Bangkok, that is Thailand. So this was a very brief introduction of Dr. Saab. And Dr. Saab, I'm sorry if I have missed out any of your important activity. So students who are interested to know more about his activity can contact him directly. So today's topic is the scope of performance-based seismic design of structures. Speaker again, Dr. Fawad Ahmed Najam. Dr. Saab, the floor is yours. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Dr. Saab. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, you are.
Thank you for this long introduction, despite of you not being feeling well, but thank you, sir. So thank you, Pakistan Society of Civil Engineers, for giving me this opportunity to talk on this very interesting and important topic, which is about the performance-based seismic design. Let me share my screen first, and then we can continue with the lecture. So I hope that the screen is visible.
The Dr. Saab, all is going on well. You are very much audible and the screen is also shared. You can move ahead, please.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Saab. So the topic is performance-based seismic design of structures and the scope of this new methodology for seismic design in Pakistan. So in this lecture, I will first introduce the idea of seismic performance-based seismic evaluation. And then we will go through some of the basic steps of this methodology. Obviously, in this one lecture, I will not be able to quickly summarize everything about this new seismic design philosophy, but I'll try to give you an idea. And then at the end of this lecture, we will explore some of the issues or aspects related to the application of this methodology in Pakistan's context. So this will be my scope of this presentation. I'll start it with one question and one picture, basically one image. And that question is very basic one. All of us have gone through that question in our daily routines, because we structural engineers, in our day-to-day routine, we deal with the issues of seismic safety and seismic risk. So we keep on asking ourselves with this question that how safe are our buildings against future earthquakes? Are we really prepared enough to handle the next big earthquake? This picture is from Balakot, and this was taken after the Kashmir 2005 earthquake, the October 2005 earthquake. And you can see here that almost 100% of the structures are completely flat on ground, resulting in severe loss of lives and property. Another picture from Balakot from the same earthquake event. And this picture was taken after 1 month of the earthquake event itself. You can see here that this person is having his shave on top of a rubble of one home. And that home basically belonged to that person. It was his own home. And now after 1 month of the earthquake, he has to do his daily routine works on top of the rubble. You can imagine from this picture that how even after an event, the structural damage as well as the social loss is kind of permanent part of the lives of the people who are experiencing or who are victim of those earthquake events. So this is a very fundamental question, which is heart of our engineering profession, especially in northern part of Pakistan, most part of Pakistan, in fact, that how safe are our buildings against earthquakes, future ground motions. So we structural engineers approach this problem of earthquake in this manner, that we have a structure on one side and we have a reasonably accurate estimate of future ground shaking on the other side. And that future ground shaking itself comes from a detailed process of probabilistic seismic hazard assessment and then site response analysis, perhaps. That itself basically is a process which gives us the future ground shaking or its representation in probabilistic terms. And what we do is that we convert our real structure into a mathematical idealization, a linear or a nonlinear analysis model. And nowadays, essentially, these models have to be finite element models. We apply those the characterization of seismic ground motions, either in the form of some anticipated ground motions at our site, or the spectrum of the future ground motion to our linear or nonlinear models, to calculate what we call as the seismic demands. And those can be also linear or nonlinear, depending upon what analysis procedure we have employed. And those demands can be global, which means the story level, or it can be at individual component level, which means at individual structural element level. So this is the overall picture of how we structural engineers deal with this issue in our day-to-day practice. So if we, on the other hand, look at the evolution of seismic design philosophy, we started with a historical approach of applying only some mass proportional equivalent earthquake forces to our structure in lateral direction. And those forces are supposed to be resisted by the linear elastic response of the building. And that historical approach is unable to tell us the remaining factor of safety or what will happen to our structure if the applied loading exceeds that loading which was used in the design of that building. So we are not aware of the remaining factor of safety. We are not. We cannot answer the question what will happen to the structure for exceeding forces compared to the design forces. The traditional building codes, on the other hand, they implicitly account for the inelastic effects of the building by introducing a so-called response modification factor or behavior factor as denoted or prescribed in Euro codes. So that R factor is supposed to reduce the elastic forces into some inelastic estimate of forces which we can use for the design purpose. And those forces, those reduced forces, are used for providing the capacity to the structure. And then we can rely on the limited inelastic action which our structure is going to have in case of the design earthquake. We assume that the structure, or we make sure that the structure have enough ductility capacity to withstand those inelastic response during design earthquake under a reasonable level of safety. So we can rely on the overstrength as well as the ductility capacity of the structure to make the design more economical. So in a sense, traditional building codes consider the inelastic effect of the structure, but in an implicit manner, by just simply reducing the elastic forces by the response modification factor to come up with an estimate of inelastic forces. The latest design philosophy, the state of the art, is that you explicitly consider the inelastic capacity using a nonlinear computer model of the structure, and then you compare it with the applied demand and calculate a compromise point between the actual nonlinear capacity of the structure as predicted by the nonlinear computer model and the actual realistic representation of the future ground shaking. So you overlay both of the capacity and demand on the same graph to come up with a compromise point, sometimes also referred to as the performance point, to calculate the most likely displacements which your future earthquake or the design earthquake is going to cause in your structure. So the idea is that you explicitly perform nonlinear analysis, either static or dynamic, to calculate the actual inelastic capacity of the structure and use that for the purpose of structural design. So if we classify different structural design approaches, we started with the intuitive design, and then there was a time when the code-based design was prevailing, and still it is governing our engineering practice. And then we have the performance-based design, the latest idea and the current state-of-the-art practice in the structural design approaches. And now we also are going to have some new ideas, mostly coming from some interdisciplinary areas. For example, the disaster preparedness or mitigation areas, or for example, resilience aspect or resilience aspect of disasters. So these are mostly used an umbrella term for them, and that is the consequence and risk-based design, and also resilience-based design, in which the concept of building design rating is introduced. But these will not be the topic for this discussion. Today we'll be focusing mainly on the performance-based design approach and its process and some of the steps involved in that. And then at the end, we will see how we can make it more practical or applicable in the context of Pakistan. So in order to first introduce this idea, we have to have a starting point in Pakistan, that where we actually stand nowadays, where, what is the current practice or what is the, you can say, current approach of design which we are using in our structures here. And then we can obviously mark the roadmap or identify some of the areas which can be used or exploited later to achieve a long-term goal of earthquake resilience in Pakistan. So if you classify the structural design practice historically in Pakistan, you can divide that history into five phases. We started with pre-partition, some seismic design provisions, especially the building code of the municipality of Quetta, which was formulated after the 1935 Quetta earthquake. And then we can have one era from 1947 to 1975, in which mostly the practitioners were using British building codes, and those British building codes are, I think, mainly because of the influence from that colonial practices. Some of the government agencies continued to use British building codes even after partition. From 1970s to 1986, the practitioners turned to American family of building codes, especially to the Uniform Building Code. The Uniform Building Code was updated on a three-year cycle up to 1997, which was the last version of UBC. So the practice primarily started governed by the UBC, the prevailing version of the UBC codes. In 1986, we have the very first National Building Code with some seismic provisions primarily used or taken from the then edition of the UBC. But that document was not enforced officially, and that was just an advisory document with some seismic provisions. So the practice even then was mainly governed by UBC, even with the 1986 Pakistan Building Code. After 2005 Kashmir earthquake, the Ministry of Housing and Works gave this task to NESPARC to develop the first ever seismic hazard maps. Basically, hazard maps were available for Pakistan even before also. In 1999, we have a very valuable study called Global Seismic Hazard Assessment Program, which developed the seismic hazard assessment maps for Pakistan also. But NESPARC explicitly developed in 2007, and they were introduced in the 2007 version of the Building Code of Pakistan, and some seismic provisions were also introduced in that. To date, in 2020, the Building Code of Pakistan was not updated until recently, that now PEC, Pakistan Engineering Council, have started an effort to improve the Building Code. And I hope that, since I am also part of that effort, I hope that we will be able to put together a good new updated Building Code of Pakistan in 2021, maybe June or July or mid of 2021. So in that code, the new seismic hazard maps will be included. Those will be improved over the existing hazard assessment results. So my discussion about the performance-based seismic design will mainly be in this domain. Some discussion will be in research and academics. Some discussion will be about the building code and the prevailing design practice, how we can integrate these two. And then towards the end, I will have a few minutes maybe on another important topic about the public education and awareness and the role of media, mass media, in creating that awareness. So let's start with the very first step, which is the introduction to the performance-based assessment methodology. So first we have the overview of this methodology, how it is different from the current code-based design procedures. And then secondly, we will see some of its important steps. And third, we can see its application in Pakistan's context. In order to differentiate how a performance-based code looks like from the prescriptive typical codes, I want to give you an example of the very first ever building code, which was developed by the King of Babylon in this duration, very long time back, maybe 4,000 years from today. The King Hammurabi put up the very first building code, and one of the you can say section or clauses of that code says that if a builder builds a house for someone and does not construct it properly, and the house which he builds falls in and kills its owner, then that builder shall be put to death. Simple, straightforward, consequence oriented and performance oriented also. If you decompose this section, it requires implicit requirements. For example, it doesn't explain what does it mean by not constructing it properly. The builder is supposed to know that already. Similarly, it also prescribes the explicit collapse performance, that if that building that falls in and kills its owner, that performance is already prescribed here, the expected performance or the collapse performance basically. And the consequence of non-performance is also there or directly in the same section. So that's how a typical performance-oriented legal requirement or code may look like, that it implicitly proposes requirements and then it explicitly prescribes the performance, what is intended and what not is intended. And then it also prescribes the consequence of if the structure is not following or not able to reach that performance which is prescribed. So another example for to explain how the prescriptive approach is different from the performance-oriented approach. I take this example from IBC 2015 section this much. And you can see here that it is talking about the height of parapet wall on the roof of the building. And it says that it should not be less than 30 inches. And if the roof is slopy, then you can have this much requirements, this much should be the thickness and everything. So there are very detailed prescriptions of how the parapet wall should be constructed, or it should be there on top of your building. On the other hand, just look at this document, a very old document, maybe 3,300 years from today. And it says that in case you build a new house, you must also make a parapet for your roof, that you may not place blood guilt upon your house because someone falling might fall from it. So the performance is directly mentioned as kind of a requirement to fulfill. So here the performance is implicitly ensured by putting some limits and some requirements, some you can say conditions. But here the only condition is that someone shouldn't fall from it. So the performance is directly prescribed here, and now the engineer or the builder should satisfy that performance. Now he should know how to do it. It doesn't give you some limits or some rules to comply with that requirement. However, the requirement directly becomes your design criteria. Here the design criteria is prescribed in terms of all of these numbers. This much thickness, that much height, that much material. But here it is directly the performance which is required. Someone shouldn't fall from it. That's all. So this is a classical difference between how a prescriptive approach, which is adopted by different building codes, is different from a performance-based approach. So building codes basically ensure public safety implicitly. How they do it, they specify requirements, they put different limits on applicable design or analysis procedures, they give acceptable solutions, they prescribe rules, limits, and different limits on structural systems. Rules for detailing, for example, in case of RC buildings. And they also provide guidelines for specifications for construction monitoring, and the list continues. So all of these things are prescribed directly. And it is assumed that if you comply to the letter of the code, you will meet the intended spirit of the code, which is public safety. So it is assumed that as long as these requirements are fulfilled, the public safety will be ensured. So this is how building codes intend to make buildings safe and sound for public. Another example for the case of inside diameter of bend in welded wire reinforcement for stirrup should not be less than this. So this is taken from ACI 318. Just as an example to show how a prescriptive code is different from a performance-based orientation or performance-based approach. The code prescribes these limits. For example, the diameter of bend should not be less than this number. Now, it doesn't tell what will happen if the diameter is more than that number. If the diameter is slightly more, there is no explicit check on any section of building code. It is just an assumption, or it is intended that you follow all these requirements and you will end up in a safe design. Similarly, examples from other traditional building codes, they all have very detailed prescriptions, equations, design charts, tables, and all those are seemingly arbitrary rounded limits, and they all have implicit meaning. No explicit check that if you don't follow a particular clause, or if you are out by even 5% or 2% by some option or some limit, what will happen to your structure? that explicit check is not there. You just have to rely on these building codes, and it is assumed that as long as you are conforming to them, your performance is going to be okay. So there are now different families of these building codes, which basically prescribe different procedures. And sometimes those are not same. Different building codes prescribe different solutions or different factors to account for the same phenomenon. So they all differ. So we are right in thinking that if they all differ, then can they all be correct at the same time? Or do we really inform our structures to follow a particular building code when an earthquake or any disaster strike? Obviously, the structure is going to follow its own dynamics or mechanics. So obviously, we cannot inform or force our structure to follow a particular building code. Similarly, these codes change every 3 to 5 years. Then what we should do with the structures which were already built according to previous code? Should we upgrade them to conform to the latest version of code or not? And also, these building codes, their intention is life safety. They don't care about whether there are any cost implications which are acceptable or not. So if you, if the life is safe in a design earthquake, the intention of building code is met already. So they don't consider the cost implications or downtime, for example, or some other important parameters which are which may be very important for the building owner or any other important stakeholder. So primarily they basically serve as a shelter for structural engineers. The public at large is interested only in one thing, that will the building is safe or not. The building owners have its own specific questions about the safety. For example, the building will collapse or will it be damaged? How much repair cost will be required in case of future earthquake? How long will it take to repair, or can I make a building that will not damage at all at a certain level of earthquake? All of these questions we are not currently in a position to explicitly answer. We mean structural engineers. All they can say is that they follow code. And as long as the letter of the code is met, is conformed, the structure is intended to perform well. But there is no explicit check on that statement. All they can say is that I follow the code. So primarily these codes serve as a shelter for us. As long as we follow it, we can be sheltered by its provisions. So this is one of the motivations for developing the performance-based seismic design philosophy, that there should be an explicit check on a code designed structure. And that check should be performed explicitly to verify whether a particular design will conform to the performance levels or the expected performance or not. So they implicitly ensure the performance and structure, the performance will be acceptable if its rules are followed. The problem is that the performance may not be acceptable in certain cases. Even a design is conforming to a particular building code, the performance may still not be acceptable in certain cases. So what we do, we change the rules every 3 years, we come up with the new versions of building code, but the process continues, or maybe we invent new rules to account for some phenomena which was not accounted for previously. So in order to just give you an idea about the difference between public expectation from structural designers or structural engineers and what they really know is, I refer to you this very interesting movie, although it's very, very old, 1974, The Towering Inferno, which I sometimes refer to my students also. In that movie, it is shown that a high-rise building is on fire, and now everyone is in panic and they are evacuating that building. And everyone wants to know, the building officials want to know, how much time it will take for the building to collapse, which is already under fire. So what they show is that the chief engineer is being called, or the architect is being called, and this question is asked from him, and he asked for the drawings and all the calculations. He sit there and perform some calculations, and after a few minutes, he said that you have just 2 hours. And then the movie continues based on that prediction or estimate of that structural engineer of 2 hours. So we know already that simulating a real building which is under fire and estimating its remaining cost itself in 2020 is very difficult. It's a very difficult task for structural engineers to actually simulate this building under fire with an intention to predict its remaining life. So this shows that in 1974, the public expectation from structural engineers was that they should be able to quickly predict the remaining life of a structure under fire. But we know now that even in 2020 for a high-rise building, this simulation or this number is very difficult to get. So this shows a lag between what is required from us and what we really know about the structural analysis and design and mechanics. The building codes, traditional building codes, they can handle these traditional systems well. They can handle moment resisting frames, shear wall frame interaction systems, or it can handle all the braced frames, different kinds of frames. So we know that these traditional systems can be easily handled in traditional building codes. But what about these innovative shapes which are coming nowadays? Architects are free to think different shapes and they just put these challenges in front of us and we have to just design them. And building codes don't really help in design of these kind of innovative building shapes. We can have buildings which are connected at different levels. We can have tubular systems. We can have diagrid systems, shell structures. We can have structures with significant vertical irregularities. All of those innovative systems are not handled in traditional building codes. Traditional building codes are meant for only low to mid-rise buildings, which are regular in shape. And mostly they are more than 90% of the building stock also, by the way, and that's why building codes mostly focus on those buildings. So the history is that in 1980 and 1990s, the owners began to question how their buildings would perform. So they don't care about the building codes and our procedures and modeling and everything. Owners only want to know their building, how their building would be performing in future earthquake. Will it be safe or not? If it is damaged, how much? How much cost will be required? So owners mostly express their desires in terms of a series of performance objectives. Performance objectives. So they say that, okay, I want my existing building to be safe under a certain level of an earthquake. I want to use my building right away after an earthquake. So I should be able to use it. So there should be no downtime. For example, I want the repair cost to be less than 20% of the replacement value. So all of these explicit performance objectives or requirements, they cannot be verified using code-based design philosophies. So you have to have an explicit check, a performance-oriented check. So these are some of the motivations. This lack of explicit performance in design codes is the primary motivation for performance-based seismic design philosophy. So it is the idea or an approach in which the structural design criteria is expressed in terms of achieving a set of performance objectives or levels. Not like the traditional code-based design in which the design criteria is primarily governed by code provisions or limits or rules or tables or charts and everything. So instead of all that, if the design criteria is expressed in terms of just a simple performance objective or a performance level, that I want my building to remain intact without any cracking at the design earthquake. Now that statement is basically a performance objective. So if that performance objective explicitly becomes your design criteria, it starts governing your design decision making, then that methodology will be called performance-based design methodology. It will create an explicit link between the structural performance and the earthquake hazard level. So it will answer the questions like how a building is likely to perform in extreme events, and it will enable us to lift all those arbitrary restrictions which are there because of the building codes. So the summary is that it is needed for the structures where traditional codes are not suitable, where you want an explicit verification or performance check on an existing design, or more importantly, the public do not care about the code or theories or procedures. They care about safety and performance. So this is the primary reason we should finally go towards this seismic design philosophy. And I want to clear one misconception about PVD here is that it is generally assumed that for all those structural systems which are already covered in traditional building codes, PVD should not be used for them because they are already covered in the codes. And it should only be used for those systems which are not covered. Basically, this is not true. In all traditional building codes, they prescribe minimum requirements for the structural analysis and design. They don't limit you to just follow only those procedures. They are always welcoming to alternate procedures if you can justify them. So an example can be given from IBC 2008 here, where this section 104.11, this is allowing the use of alternate materials, design and methods of construction. So if you can go through this, this clause will allow you to use any other rational method of structural design if you can justify it. So performance-based design is kind of allowed for all structures, not only for those who are not covered in the traditional building codes. You can apply this methodology to any kind of structural system. So in the new version of our National Building Code of Pakistan, we will be having an allowance for the use of alternate design procedures. And that will cover basically that will give you a freedom to use performance-based design if you want to use it. So the essence is that a decision maker, which can be the building owner or it can be any important stakeholder, he states a desire that a building should be able to perform in a certain way. That desire can be anything. That desire can be life safety. That desire can be no cracking in columns. That desire can be minimize potential repair cost. Can be anything. That performance objective or performance level can be any description which the decision maker desires. And the engineer uses his or her skill to provide a design that should be able to achieve that objective. This is the essence of performance-based design. That's all. If there is a definition for this methodology, it is that one. That a decision maker desires a performance, an engineer should use his skills to achieve that performance. An example can be given. For example, if you want a concrete of 21 megapascal, this is an implicit expectation. What you will do is, in prescriptive approach, you will specify a mixed design, 1:2:4, let's say. And the implicit expectation would be that this mix is going to produce 21 megapascal. So that prescription, that mixed design, will be prescriptive approach, the building codes approach. On the other hand, the performance-based approach will not put emphasis on procedures. It will put emphasis on key performance indicators. It will directly specify that any concrete less than 21 megapascal is rejected. Now it's your headache to produce that 21 megapascal using different mix proportions or everything. So you are free to choose any method as long as you are resulting in a concrete which is more than 21 megapascal. So this is a difference between how building codes approach to the problem and how the performance-based approach basically uses or handles the problem. Now the performance objective set by the building owner or any important stakeholder is a set of two things. First of all, it is the maximum acceptable damage or the description of the maximum acceptable damage which your structure is going to have, the maximum acceptable level of that damage, corresponding to a ground motion or the hazard level. So both of these information, they combine together to make performance objective. So I would say that, okay, at that particular ground motion level, I want no cracking in my shear wall. This will become my performance objective. Or it can be like this, that at this much ground motion level, I want no repair cost for my columns. So that can be my performance objective. That ground motion is basically nowadays is described in probabilistic framework and that is X percent probability of exceedance in Y years. So it will say that in these much years in future, this much percent is allowed to have an earthquake more than the level which is being used. For example, if I say 2% probability of exceedance in 50 years, and by the way, this corresponds to a return period of 2475 years, almost 2500 years. So this means simply that in next 50 years, there is only 2% chance that an earthquake having more higher than this level will occur or will happen in next 50 years. In 10% probability of exceedance in 50 years mean that in next 50 years, there is a 10% chance that an earthquake higher than this will occur. So basically, as you are increasing that probability of exceedance, you are reducing the hazard level. Basically, you are reducing the return period. And for 10% probability of exceedance, it is almost 475 years. And for 50% probability of exceedance in 30 years, it is 43 years almost. So this three level of ground motions are kind of standard templates to describe the level of earthquake, future earthquake in performance-based design philosophy. So that 2% basically corresponds or is called to MCE level, maximum considered earthquake level. 10% corresponds to DBE level, the design basis earthquake level. It is defined as the level on which the structure should be designed. And the 50% in 30 years is basically service level earthquake. At this level, basically, the serviceability of the structure should be checked. At MCE level, the detailed performance assessment should be performed. This return period of 43 years shows that it is a frequent earthquake. So for frequent earthquakes, we check the serviceability. For moderate level earthquakes, we design the structure. And for very rare earthquakes, which means an earthquake which almost on average repeats itself every 2500 years, we check the performance or detail collapse assessment of the structure is performed at that level. So these are the three kind of template hazard levels which are used in performance-based assessment methodology. Similarly, for performance levels or the description of the maximum acceptable damage, we also have few templates. And those are in different prescribed in different performance-based design guidelines, as mentioned here. So these templates are like operational, immediate occupancy, life safety, and collapse prevention. And you might already guess by now that as I'm going towards right-hand side, the damage is increasing. Operational means fully intact. Immediate occupancy, as the name indicates, means that there is very minor damage. Life safety means that there can be some damage, but life overall is safe. And collapse prevention means that there is significant damage, but the structure as a whole is not catastrophically going down. It is still standing somehow. So these are the, you can say, the descriptions of damage or performance levels, which should be used as a template by building owners or other stakeholders to describe the level of damage in their buildings. So joining these performance levels with the seismic hazard level will become your performance objective. So these are the descriptions of operational level, immediate occupancy, as the name indicates that the occupancy should be restored immediately after an earthquake, that the damage is that minor that you should be able to occupy that building immediately and there is no damage required or there is no repair or anything required. Life safety, the intention is that there can be significant structural damage, but no loss of life should occur. And collapse prevention means that significant damage can occur, but the structure should still remain standing, should not collapse completely. So now using what we call as the nonlinear analysis or nonlinear modeling, we can make an explicit link between the seismic hazard and performance levels. So as the hazard level is increasing, the level of earthquake ground motion is increasing, the structural displacements are also increasing. And if we have a nonlinear model, then we can have a nonlinear curve, which by the way, sometimes is called pushover curve in nonlinear static procedures. and we can relate each point on that curve with a description of a damage. So we just selected four descriptions as a template, operational, IO, LS, and then CP. So these are kind of template descriptions of damage, which we can repeatedly use. So if we somehow calculate the level of damage in terms of these performance levels, we can relate that damage to any other key performance indicator. For example, that damage can be converted to even the expected number of casualties or downtime for rehabilitation. There are models available which convert your analysis results or the damage of your structure as predicted by the nonlinear model of your computer, nonlinear model. You convert them into casualties or downtime or rehabilitation cost also. So that damage can be converted to any other performance indicator. So we can now explicitly answer some of the questions using this methodology asked by the building owners. Because all of those questions about safety, about damage or repair cost, they can be related to the amount of yielding or buckling or cracking or permanent deformation in your computer model. So if you have a detailed nonlinear analysis results, you can explicitly answer some of these questions. So for the very first time, the owner and the stakeholders and the structural engineer or performance-based engineer, they can have a meaningful conversation. And obviously you must have a third-party peer review in the performance-based design approach, because just like the traditional code-based approach have a vetting process, performance-based approach also have a peer review process. So in this methodology, you are required to perform a service level evaluation, which is the analysis at a level which is lower than the design value, which is used by building codes. And you are also required to perform a collapse level assessment, which is the analysis at an earthquake, which is higher than the design earthquake. So this is basically performed at SLE level. And at DBE level, the design is performed. The code-based approach basically defines the design level of an earthquake as having an earthquake with 10% probability of exceedance in 50 years, as I mentioned earlier. And the collapse level assessment is performed at MCE level, which is a higher level corresponding to a return period of 2,500 years almost. So the expectation from structure side for all of these three levels is different. For SLE level, we may not allow any cracking, any level of nonlinearity, because this is a frequent earthquake. So very negligible damage should occur at this level if the structure has to pass the performance check. But at collapse prevention assessment, we may allow significant nonlinearity. We may allow cracking and some damage as long as the building as a whole is passing the collapse prevention check or is passing the collapse prevention performance level. So we perform service level evaluation and collapse level evaluation as part of the PBD methodology. The DBE level evaluation is already being done by the code-based design, because DBE is defined in codes also with the same definition which is prescribed in different building guidelines or standards about PBD. So now we have the PBD specialist, which is different from a code-based structural designer. And that is having a correspondence with not only the structural designer, but also with its peer reviewer. And then it is also having, is consulting with the site-specific consultant for getting the hazard levels, MCE, DBE, and SLE level evaluations. And obviously this peer reviewer is also having a correspondence with the structural engineer, the original engineer or designer. So at the end, the structural engineer will get a lot of recommendations by the PBD specialist as well as by the PBD peer reviewer to improve the structural design or to reduce some of the elements or whatever is the PBD output, the structural engineer will get as a recommendation to incorporate if the PBD is done. So the very first generation of performance-based design methodology was prescribing nonlinear static procedures, which are also called as the pushover analysis procedure. And the reason was that nonlinear dynamic analysis was not that common, and the computational power few years back was not that enough to handle large projects and dynamic analysis. But the second generation nowadays prescribe the explicit application of nonlinear dynamic analysis at the heart of the performance-based design philosophy. So you have to perform the check at two levels. At two seismic hazard levels should be considered. The nonlinear modeling and analysis is required in PBD. This is the very important point. At the heart of performance-based design philosophy is the nonlinear modeling. So you cannot have this PBD methodology for any structure unless you know nonlinear modeling or nonlinear analysis. Another important point is that you must have the acceptance criteria, which means the acceptable level of seismic demands against each performance level. So only having IULS and CP is not required. You also have to have real numbers which can represent your IO level or LS level and CP level. Those numbers are called acceptance criteria. So after the analysis, the element by element checking is done. For example, for each beams and each column and each shear wall, you check whether it passes that IO level criteria or LS level or CP level. So at each element, you perform that performance assessment using these numbers, which are called acceptance criteria. And this criteria is prescribed or not prescribed, basically different guidelines give you guidance about these criteria, that what numbers you should use for each element as your acceptance criteria against each performance level. So it will tell you, for example, at material level, this much strain, 0.0001, will be your IO level strain, and 0.002 will be your LS level strain, and 0.003 in concrete will be your CP level strain. So these numbers will be coming from different guidelines and different publications and research and all that. They guide you what numbers you should use corresponding to each performance level. So these numbers, in a short word, they are basically converting your physical descriptions of damage into some quantifiable numbers which you can get from your computer model and then convert your model into a kind of a damage description of your structure. So a quick overview of the methodology up till now. I think you start with the conventional design. You start with the architectural drawings, and then you perform linear elastic modeling. And then you carry out the code-based design at DBE level. That can be in earthquake context. It can be equivalent lateral force procedure, or it can be the response spectrum analysis procedure. So the traditional design process is up till here. But for PVD, obviously, you will go beyond that, and you will calculate the true capacities of all structural elements which are designed in previous step. So the design is used as an input for the performance-based design, the original design or the starting design. Just like the preliminary design sizes and detailing is used as an input for the code-based design. So now the code-based final design will be used as an input for performance assessment. Using the capacities of all structural elements, nonlinear capacities basically, you will construct what we call as a nonlinear computer model. And that model, obviously, you have to perform service level evaluation and maximum considered earthquake level evaluation. For service level evaluation, because it is a low level earthquake, which is a frequent earthquake, only the linear elastic model and the response spectrum analysis procedure is enough. So you can use the previous design model for service level evaluation. But for MCE level evaluation, you have to have a nonlinear model, and you first have to select the time histories, the selection and modification of ground motions for the MCE level evaluation. So then you have to perform the detailed nonlinear time history analysis, the dynamic analysis, to come up with the SLE and MCE level demands, SLE from here, MCE from here, and then you check with them with the acceptance criteria. If the performance is okay in terms of acceptance criteria, then you finish that process. But if it is not okay, then you can change the design and then repeat that performance assessment. so that original design will be changed, even if it is conforming to a particular code. If it is not passing the performance assessment criteria, checking by the acceptance criteria, and then the design will be changed and then the process will be repeated. So this is the overview of performance-based design process. And obviously, as you might have guessed already, that you need to have some additional input information in order to conduct that methodology. And that additional information will be obviously the performance objectives and the corresponding acceptance criteria, the numbers, which will tell you the acceptable level of seismic demands for each performance level. You must also have the geotechnical investigation studies. And obviously, you have to have SLE, MCE, and DBE spectra in order to perform service level evaluation and MCE level evaluation. So you must also have the probabilistic seismic hazard assessment results. And also, you must also have the wind tunnel testing results if the wind also governs the design, and you must have the accurate representation of wind loading at appropriate levels of return periods. That is a different, complete different story. Most of the northern part of Pakistan, wind doesn't govern, and therefore only performance assessment for wind design should be performed. And in order to get that acceptance criteria, which becomes our key, checking point at PBD level, different special purpose guidelines can be used, and I list some of them, and you can explore them later to have more information about the PBD methodology. But now the important point is that these new guidelines explicitly prescribe the nonlinear dynamic analysis for the purpose of MCE level evaluation. So unlike the previous generation where you were using the nonlinear static procedures or pushover analysis procedures, now you use the nonlinear dynamic analysis procedure. This methodology is although explicitly developed for earthquake load, but ideally it is applicable to all types of loads. So although primarily it is available now for earthquake loads, but we have the very first standard recently by ASCE, a pre-standard for the performance-based wind design. So now in the coming years, we will also have this methodology extended to even wind design also, because in its essence, the idea can be extended to any kind of loads or any kind of structures also. Some more information that in this methodology, we classify our elements into primary or secondary. And we give a nonlinear force deformation behavior to each of the primary or secondary component of our structure. And that's why as a whole, our structural model becomes nonlinear, and it is able to give us the real structural damage, which we can convert into any performance indicator later. The primary components are defined as the one which are critical. So very conservative values of IO, LS, and CP are taken for these. The acceptance criteria is a very strict criteria for critical components. For secondary components, the criteria is not that critical. We may allow a large level of inelasticity for secondary components. So another classification we have to perform is about the actions. So within one component, we can have different actions, for example, moment, shear, torsion, axial load, etc. So for those actions also, we can classify them either as deformation controlled or force controlled. For deformation controlled, we give them a kind of a ductile force deformation behavior, a ductile behavior. But for force controlled actions, we give them a very brittle kind of a behavior. So this kind of a classification you have to perform before you start that methodology. I give you an example. For example, in RC columns, you have two kinds of actions which are governing the design and performance. One is the axial flexural interaction action, and second is the shear action. The axial flexural behavior can be considered a ductile behavior because it is going to have a ductile failure. So we can classify it as ductile and give a ductile force deformation behavior for this action. But for shear failure, since it is a brittle failure, so we classify this action as brittle and we give a brittle force deformation behavior to that action. Similarly, we can classify all the elements and their action types and give them some appropriate nonlinear behavior. And at the end of the analysis, whether it is nonlinear static analysis or nonlinear dynamic analysis, the software calculates demand to capacity ratios. And if the member is brittle, the demand to capacity ratio is checked in terms of forces. For example, the nominal capacity in a beam, maximum bending moment in a beam, MU, divided by the moment capacity of that beam, MN. So that DC ratio is in terms of strengths. But if, for example, a member or action is ductile, then the DC ratio is calculated in terms of deformations. For example, the maximum strain produced by the applied loading divided by the strain capacity of that material, maybe 0.003 or any capacity. That capacity can be IO, LS, and CP. And therefore, the software can use this IO, LS, and CP strains as capacities one by one to calculate the DC ratios for each performance level. So for example, for life safety performance level, if DC ratio is more than one, we say that this member has crossed already the life safety performance level. So, but it is possible that for CP, the DC ratio for the same element should be, it will be less than one. So we can say that this element is somewhere between LS level and CP level. So it passes the collapse prevention criteria, but doesn't pass the life safety criteria. So that's how we classify different actions corresponding elements based on the DC ratios, which is calculated either in terms of forces for brittle elements and in terms of deformations for ductile elements. So as I mentioned earlier, that if you are performing the service level evaluation, then only the linear elastic model is okay. So you can use the linear elastic model. But if your expected performance is this one, in case of MCE level, then you cannot use the linear elastic model. You have to have the nonlinear model. So we have to learn the nonlinear modeling if we want to perform the maximum considered earthquake level evaluation. So that nonlinear analysis can be either pushover analysis or the nonlinear dynamic time history analysis. For service level evaluation, either the linear static procedure, the equivalent lateral force procedure, or the response spectrum procedure is enough. If you want to go more than that, then you can also have the linear dynamic analysis procedure, the linear time history analysis procedure also. So obviously, in order to perform all of these analyses, both at service level as well as at the collapse prevention level, you have to have a good familiarity with some of the finite element based software. For service level evaluation, either ETABS or SAP can be used, or StatPro can be used. But for nonlinear modeling and analysis, one option can be that you use SAP 2000 or Perform 3D, which is also a product of CSI. But in ETABS 2016 onwards, the nonlinear modeling also is included in that. And therefore, we can also perform a nonlinear analysis and modeling in ETABS 2016 onwards. So this was all about some of the basic concepts of PBD methodology. And obviously, you will not be able to quickly understand some of the details of that procedure. But you may have an overall idea about some of the things which we do in that. Now, let's discuss what are some of the challenges and opportunities in the context of Pakistan for the application of this seismic design philosophy. Because one thing is for sure that this is the future for the engineering practice. And ultimately, nonlinear modeling will prevail as we will have more technological advancement in terms of software and other developments. So the challenges and opportunities, I divide them into four main categories. One is the accurate characterization of the seismic hazard of Pakistan. As long as you don't have an accurate SLE, DBE, and MCE level spectra, or the representation of future ground shaking, you may not perform that methodology. You cannot have that information without accurate characterization of seismic hazard. The second issue is the site or soil characteristics. the local soil amplification effects, the basin effect, the you can say site response analysis. We have to have that information about our local sites. The other two issues are related to capacity building. For example, nonlinear modeling is itself a big thing to do. The common practicing engineers in Pakistan are currently not using it, and it is not explicitly being utilized for performance assessment. And obviously, if you don't have the capacity to have nonlinear model or construct it, you cannot perform the nonlinear static or dynamic analysis. So the last two issues are related to capacity building or the overall, you can say, prevailing use of these procedures. But the top two one, these are related to research and development and having that data or producing that data for our local scenario or local aspect. So very first one is about the accurate characterization of seismic hazard. Unfortunately, we are located on an area which has a very complex seismotectonics. Half part of our country is on one tectonic plate. The other half part is on another one. In the north, we have a direct head-on collision between these two plates. In the middle, we have somehow strike slip or an angular strike slip between these two plates. So they are kind of converging. And in the south, we have a subduction zone, which we call as the Makran subduction zone, where the Arabian plate is subducting under the Eurasian plate. So this is a very complex seismotectonic environment. Very few countries in the world have this kind of all the environments in one country. So we have these three zones. We have North Kulian boundary. We have Quetta transverse zone, where we have some strike slip faults. And we also have a Makran subduction zone in the south. So this results in a very complex network of different crustal faults which are spread along this main plate boundary in this manner. So all those faults you can see here in this figure, they are all spread along this main plate boundary. So here we have directly thrust faults, but here we can have strike slip faults, and here we have this subduction zone. So all this complex seismotectonic environment has resulted in large number of, you can say, significant earthquakes in last 100 years. Although 100 years is not a big duration as long as we are discussing these seismic events, but still in that 100 year data, we can find different, many large magnitude earthquakes in this region. So historical seismicity is available, but it's not verified for accuracy, by the way. But this is available for seismic hazard assessment studies. So we know that all the shallow earthquakes are mostly spread along the main plate boundary. And all the deep earthquakes here, you can see that they are concentrated in the Hindu Kush region. So although their magnitude and distance is not explicitly verified for accuracy, but we can still use it for seismic hazard assessment as an input to forecast the level and location of future earthquakes. So here you can see that all the shallow seismicity, less than 30 kilometer deep earthquakes, they are all spread along the main plate boundary, which is coming from Nepal to Karakoram, Himalayas, and then enter in Pakistan, and then it has this shape. Similarly, all the deep seismicity is mostly concentrated in this region. Sometimes the large magnitude earthquakes, although they are very deep, but they can still affect some of the northern part or areas in Pakistan. So going back to the same question and same thing, that how safe are our buildings against these earthquakes if they repeat themselves in future? So as you know already, that the standard seismic hazard map, which is developed as part of the effort for Building Code of Pakistan in 2007, it classifies the country into five zones. From 1 to 4, and based on different PGA values, which were calculated as the result of PSHA conducted by NESPAC in 2007. Now this map is going to get replaced by an updated map, and that will not be based on the zones. And obviously that will be based on the idea of distributed plasticity. We are going to get SS and S1 maps. So where each point on the site can have a different SS and S1 value, depending upon the hazard parameters at that site. And then this designer can use an updated equivalent lateral force procedure in conjunction with the new maps which are going to be developed as part of the new code. So here, since I have already involved in the development of the new seismic hazard assessment maps, let me show you an overview of some of the preliminary results which we are getting. These results are from a PSHA conducted at NUST, but obviously they will be integrated with another PSHA conducted in UET Peshawar. So they will be integrated, and a consensus map, which may look like close to these maps, will be included in the updated building code of Pakistan. Here you can see the peak ground acceleration with 10% probability of exceedance in 50 years, which means the DBE level. And you can see that almost whole of the country is having a PGA in this range, I think up to 0.5G. Some of the areas in the north and in upper Balochistan are having a PGA in the range of 0.4 to 0.5G. The same map for MCE level, 2% probability of exceedance in 50 years. You can identify the areas, and obviously each point on these maps is now having a different SS and S1 value. So the seismic design philosophy is now modified from PGA based to spectral acceleration based. So that's why we also have these spectral acceleration maps. For example, this is the map for spectral acceleration at 0.2 second, which is also known as the SS value. And this is for DBE level, by the way. So you can have SS now. And similarly, this is the MCE level SS. And also we have S1 map, spectral acceleration at 1 second for DBE level, and then for MCE level. And also we have maps for spectral acceleration at 2 seconds, although obviously the performance-based design methodology or the latest building codes do not make use of this spectral acceleration at 2 seconds, but we still develop to get an insight about the hazard at the very long period structures, for example, 2 seconds, maybe 20-story or 25-story buildings, both at DBE level as well as MCE level. So this is the MCE level map for spectral acceleration at 2 seconds. Another issue which I want to highlight is about the local soil effects, which we should characterize in order to get an overview of what we should, what values of hazard we should use at our surface level sites. In order to give you an idea about how important that issue is, just one example quickly, that the only history available in literature for Kashmir 2005 earthquake is in Aptabad, and that is in this report. And that is this one, the east, west, north, south, and the vertical component is reported. And if you compare its spectra with the standard design response spectrum, which is prescribed in the UBC 97 and also adopted in the Building Code of Pakistan in 2007, if you overlay the actual recorded spectra, I mean the spectra of the recorded ground motion, on this standard shape, which is the typical short period shape of spectrum, which is having a peak value in a range of around 0.2 second to 0.5 second, between basically T naught and TS, which is in typically this range. If you overlay them here, because this is also available in literature, so I just overlaid the black line, which is the spectrum of the Kashmir 2005 earthquake as recorded, overlay it on different design spectra as prescribed by the Building Code of Pakistan for different soil types. The observation is obvious that between the time period of 1 to 2 seconds, you have a very high amplification of the actual recorded spectra, which is not expected, by the way. The peak should be in this that range if the shape is actually characterizing the typical shallow crustal earthquakes. In that case, the peak should be in that range. But the peak is in the range of 1 second to 2 seconds. So obviously in that range, you can see here that even for the highest line, the actual spectral acceleration is almost 2 times compared to what is predicted by the standard design spectrum by the Building Code of Pakistan. And if you consider the response spectrum analysis procedure, everything is scaled by the... I think someone... may I request again to please mute your microphones? so that I can continue. Right, so I was saying that the actual experienced spectral acceleration by the buildings there in Aptabad was twice as much as what is predicted by the standard response spectrum, design response spectrum prescribed in building code. So in response spectrum analysis, everything is scaled by the spectral acceleration. So 2 times spectral acceleration means 2 times story shear, 2 times story moments, 2 times story drifts. Everything is doubled because of that. So this amplification is basically a footprint, or is basically a kind of an indication of the local soil effect. And I ask this question every time in different seminars, that what is your idea about this unexpected amplification in a range where it shouldn't be in from 1 to 2 seconds. And this is clearly an indication of local soil effect, that amplification. So we don't know anything about these kind of amplifications, these abnormal behaviors or basin effect in our local context in Pakistan. Another issue is about VS30 value, which is the only parameter on which, basically there are two others, but most important parameter on which the soil classes are defined by NEHRP and some other design standards or performance based guidelines. So these are this is an example of the studies which we require currently. This map of Pakistan shows the VS30 values, the approximate values of VS30 as determined by an approximate slope derived method. So we must have an idea about, you can say, the quality of soil at our local sites. All these dots or points here are the experimental values, which are almost in accordance with the approximate values calculated as part of developing this map. The last 2 points are about the capacity building, and that is about the nonlinear structural modeling and corresponding nonlinear structural analysis. The nonlinear structural modeling, currently, I think you might get an idea that for PVD, you require that. You have to have that technology already. But it is not limited only to PVD. Just imagine that you have to model masonry infill walls. Their behavior is very tricky because they contribute initially to the frames, but they are the first one to crack and leave the participation to stiffness in the frames. So their actual behavior can only be modeled using a nonlinear model. Similarly, the modeling of local structural systems, modeling of historical and poorly executed buildings, all of these issues require learning nonlinear modeling, because these are the behaviors which can be captured only through a nonlinear analysis. So not only PVD, but you need nonlinear modeling results for other purpose also. This is an example of what you will get if you have a nonlinear analysis, first model and then analysis. These are the results from an example building, the nonlinear dynamic analysis of an example building, that the nonlinear model itself can tell you the structural model directly in terms of DC ratios. So all those blue elements of shear walls, this is basically shear wall cracking. So all the blue elements have strains in them, which are 25% of the cracking strain. Then the green means 50%, yellow means 80%, and red means that the strains in these elements are already exceeded from the cracking strain value, which is prescribed in the nonlinear model. So all those red elements are already cracked. So this is an example of the result which you can get from the nonlinear analysis. You will get the damage directly from the analysis. No coefficients factors required from code, no R factor, no displacement amplification factor, nothing. No overstrength factor. You need only a nonlinear model to capture all those inelastic effects explicitly. So similarly, for one ground motion, you have a different damage. Another ground motion, another damage. Third ground motion, another damage. So this picture can be shown even to client. I mean, even a non-technical person can understand that what does these colors mean. Red means almost already cracked. Yellow means almost about to crack. And other two means that they are far before cracking. Similarly, those was the results for nonlinear dynamic analysis. But we also have nonlinear static analysis or pushover analysis. we can understand the progression of structural damage by pushing the structure and checking what damage has happened at each level of the push. So we can have, for example, at very low drift values, we can understand that, okay, brick walls begin to crack. But at some more push, we see that, okay, the shear walls begin to crack. Then we push it more, and then we get some other damages. So we can even understand the progression of structural damage to understand the behavior, that what are some of the earlier elements which are going to leave the contribution in structure stiffness matrix. So to give you an example of the same building, this animation or this movie shows you the pushover analysis of a high-rise building, and the same cracking of shear wall is being shown at each level of the push. So this is the 3D view here, and then on the right you have the elevation view. So you say that as you can see that as the building is being pushed in lateral direction, the more and more elements are becoming red, which means that they are being cracked. So the damage originates at the base and it propagates towards upper direction. Obviously the base, because the base will have the highest moments and shears. So that's why the cracking starts at the base and it originates on from up to the top of the structure. So this is a very clear picture, even as I mentioned earlier, that even your client will be able to understand that this is going to happen to your structure at that particular level. So you will be able to answer his questions explicitly for the very first time if you have a nonlinear model. Similarly, for nonlinear analysis, you might already know, so let me skip that one. And nonlinear analysis, I mean that you have the static pushover analysis, can be single mode, can be multi-mode, and on top of that, you have the detailed nonlinear response history analysis. So this whole spectrum will be open for you if you learn nonlinear modeling. Otherwise, you will just restrict yourself to the linear elastic analysis, which means the equivalent static procedure or the response spectrum analysis or the linear response history analysis. So the whole spectrum will be opened with the nonlinear modeling. So before going to my last part, which will take maybe 5 more minutes, let me show you a quick demonstration, maybe 1 or 2 minutes, on one of the software about nonlinear modeling, and that is Perform 3D. Please don't worry about that, that interface. Just check here that you have a building model, which is a 3-story building, and it is a nonlinear model. So all the damage, everything, it is able to predict. So you can perform an analysis and get the results in terms of whether it passed the IO level or LS level or CP level, and you can perform the performance assessment on that. So just a quick demonstration that, let's say that it is a nonlinear model and it already has beams, columns, and the connection panels, all three of them are nonlinear now. So let's see that how we can quickly get the performance of the building in case of an earthquake. So let me select an earthquake load case because I have already run it. So the results are readily available. And from here, I want to say that, for example, I am asking the software that I want to check the immediate occupancy performance level, whether the elements are passing it or not. So I select immediate occupancy, and this is my ranges of DC ratios. So one means red, which means that whenever DC ratio is more than one, you make that element red. And yellow means 0.9, green means 0.8, etc. So after the analysis, what I can do is that I can quickly classify elements based on these colors and based on different performance levels. Currently, I have selected immediate occupancy and the default colors, and let me animate the deflected shape of this structure under this earthquake, which is by default, it is run already. So now the structure is shaking, and during that shaking, different elements are classified in different colors. So you can exactly see which element has already crossed the IO level, the one which is in the red color, and which element which is about to cross, that is yellow. So some of the beams are already red, some of the beams are yellow, some are blue, and some of the connections also are red. For example, I don't know if you can see or not, but these corner connections are also red. So which means that these connections are also gone during that earthquake. So you can actually, as I said earlier, you can show it to anyone. This is understandable by almost all stakeholders. They will exactly, you just have to tell what different color mean to them, and then they can quickly visualize that during an earthquake, this is the condition of the structure which you can expect during that real earthquake which you have applied. Similarly, for example, I want to check life safety, I want to check collapse prevention, I can do anything. Similarly, for another earthquake, or for example, maybe go for the pushover load case, and I can plot again the same IO, LS, and CP. For example, I say immediate occupancy and plot, and then I can play that animation, and the structure is being pushed now, and you can see what is happening to the structure as it is being pushed in X direction. So you can say that first few beams are red, which means they cross the IO level, then few columns, and at the end, most of the elements at that particular roof drift, when you push it too much, most of them just cross that immediate occupancy level. So these are an example of the results which you can get if you know nonlinear modeling and you perform nonlinear analysis. Very interesting, easily understandable, and explicitly answering all of your questions. You don't need to say that I just follow the code. You can exactly tell what is going to happen to that structure in a particular earthquake. So let me go back and go to last part of my presentation, and that is about the role of mass media. I'll just wrap my everything on in just 2-3 minutes. Have you already known about this drop, cover, and hold kind of a notion for most of the developing countries which are susceptible to earthquakes? We don't have anything like that. Right from school levels, different developed countries which have already, you can say, understood the seismic risk of their country well enough, they start teaching their kids or their school-going students about some of the aspects of disaster management or disaster risk. This will basically sensitize the general public and help them in perceiving the actual level of risk which they are having. In our case, even we have the cultural memory available in case of 2005 Kashmir earthquake, still that level of perceived risk is not adequate in some parts of our country. So this is also an important aspect which we need to address. I mean, all of our efforts in all of our detailed procedures and everything will be of no use or little use if we just forget that aspect. So sometimes I write magazine articles to sensitize people about seismic risk in our country, or just to educate general masses about that. But I soon realized that if I have to reach to a wider audience, I have to write in Urdu. So I sometimes write in local newspapers also to educate general public about the seismic risk aspects and hazard aspects. And very interesting example I want to give you here, and that I give, by the way, in every seminar, is that in maybe 1 or 2 years back, I wrote an article in one of the leading newspapers, a leading media company, and I wanted to make that title very catchy, so I made that title, Agla Bada Zalzala Kab Aayega? And my point was that since you cannot predict it, it's always good to have prepared yourself, and it's the only way to mitigate is to get prepared earlier, and you cannot answer it explicitly ke agla bada zalzala kab aayega. But interestingly, when the article was published, the title was changed to this ke agla bada zalzala kab aayega, mahireen ki chonka dene wali patient hui. So this gives you an example of kind of a mainstream media company, and how sensitive they are about some of the aspects of disaster risk and management, and they just use it for the purpose of publicity or something. So yeah, this gives you an idea that at what level we need to work. So and by the way, when that article was published, the reaction of our general public was even more interesting. Hundreds of people commented on that how dare you can predict ke agla bada zalzala kab aayega. I mean, it is only God who knows ke kab aayega. So no one just opened that. Hundreds of people, without opening that article or reading it, they just commented on the title itself, and the whole point was lost. So this is a classical example of what happens when you don't educate your people. So what I do sometimes is that I create these infographics in Urdu to just educate our next generation or our kids. Or I'm also trying to get some of these included in our national curriculum also, so that our kids know some of the physical causes of earthquakes and some of the terminology, and more importantly, what they should do before, during, and after earthquake. We don't have that kind of an education in our general public. So let me skip all these. So I would like to end on this this idea that it is not only even research or academics, or it's not only building code or only practicing engineers. All of the stakeholders need to work together, and all of the important, you can say, authorities, the government authorities or enforcement agencies, disaster preparedness and response authorities, they all need to work in an integrated manner to come up with a long-term goal, or to achieve that long-term goal of earthquake resilience in Pakistan. So I would like to end here. And by the way, this is Balakot today. And I hope that we will not be able to see again it as was depicted in the picture on which I started this presentation. So we hope all that it will remain it like this forever. So I thank you to Pakistan Society of Civil Engineers to give me this opportunity. And I also thank you to all of you to give me that attention for this lecture. And I would like to answer if you have any questions. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Saab. The lecture was very nice, articulated, and full of knowledge. And I'm pretty sure our audience participants must have enjoyed the lecture and would benefit from him, from this lecture. Now we will open the question answer session. So first, there are three questions. Let me read them one by one. And after these three questions are answered, if somebody has any question, he can come on the mic by raising his hand.
I think you are not feeling well. So sir, let me read myself. Please allow me to handle that question answer session myself.
Okay, now there are three questions which let me see if I can share the screen.
Okay, I can see it myself, sir. Tahir Sahib, let me read myself.
Okay, thank you, sir.
The first question is from Mohammed Imran. Standard stirrup and tie hooks are limited because if larger bar sizes are used, it will be tend to pop out under high load. I mean, you're talking about buckling of rebars. It's not question. Okay, so this is your comment. So let me repeat that comment to all of the other participants, that these standard stirrup and tie hooks are limited because if larger bar sizes are used, it will tend to pop out under high load. I think what Mr. Imran want to emphasize is on the local buckling of rebars under compression forces. So yes, this is an important aspect. Another question is from Mr. Yasir Mahmood, that sir, why do we check the collapse prevention performance level for the lower probability of earthquake only 2%? Should it not be conducted for the earthquakes which are more frequent, maybe the ones at dBE level, or maybe for gravity return period of 50%? See, when you are checking the performance level for a high level of an earthquake, and that performance level is collapse prevention, that collapse prevention is only associated with that high level of an earthquake. I mean, these are, you can say, the performance objectives are the desired or expected levels of damage at different seismic hazard levels. So obviously you will not want your structure to completely collapse during a service level earthquake or a design basis earthquake. So what you are doing is that you are checking it for even cracking. So you are putting it on a very high level of a criteria, even for service level earthquake. So obviously, if a structure is passing the service level criteria, which is no cracking at all, it is not going to collapse also. So the other two levels are already satisfied. So you can say the description of damages are increasing with the seismic hazard level. So these comprise our standard performance objectives. So another question is that performance-based design procedures such as the incremental dynamic analysis takes too long to run. Is it feasible to do in industry for large structures? I did work on 2D structure, not a 3D structure, and I took like forever.
May I explain, sir, if you don't mind? I was running a 25-story building and I was running ID analysis. I extracted the 2D frame from the main 3D structure. All right. And it took me like 3 months total, right? And my PGA range was from 0.02 to 0.5 only. All right. So that means my PGA levels was not that higher, but it took a lot of time. And I have a decent system. I mean, it's not a bad laptop. It's like a 8th generation laptop and it's doing still good. But my question is that, is it still feasible to do in the industry? Because any company, any consultancy firm doesn't have this long time. And if you want to do it, of course, you need the very high-end PCs. That is the first thing, right? So how can we incorporate into the industry right now at this moment?
First of all, I would like to say that incremental dynamic analysis is not required as part of PBD. You only have to perform the nonlinear dynamic analysis once for MCE level evaluation. Yes, okay. You have to perform it for maybe 11 ground motions according to the latest guidelines. But mm-hmm. even for those 11 ground motions, you just have to perform once at mm-hmm. that MCE level evaluation. So IDA is a different thing. IDA okay. is a different story, and that obviously will require to repeat that nonlinear time history analysis several times, many times, maybe hundreds yeah. of times. Here you only have to perform it once. So with the latest ETABs, I have done it with Perform 3D several times, and I know that it depends on, by the way, the complexity of the structure, but around 40-story building for 50-second earthquake takes around 1 to 2 days in Perform 3D. Mm-hmm. Similarly, in ETABs, it is even faster. 3 million equations in 1 second, ETABs, the latest versions. So that's why we recommend nowadays, I mean, I'm also recommending my students to have an idea about how we can develop nonlinear modeling in ETABs. So, because it may provide us faster results. The traditional okay. design offices in around the globe, which do these performance-based assessments, they take around 1 month to carry out the nonlinear modeling and analysis for one 40 to 50 story building. The time can be significantly reduced by employing ETABs, by the way. So IDA is a different story. PBD will not be taking that much time as you have experienced in IDA.
Okay, so that means we can go with the pushover analysis for the time being.
I mean, even nonlinear time history analysis is not going yeah. to take much. I mean, in for example, Perform 3D, there is a parallel computing option also. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can join 2-3 systems and you can take benefit of all of their processing power. So I don't think that these issues are still relevant nowadays. I mean, 5-10 years earlier, okay, I can understand that computational power was an issue. But now I think no issue. With faster solvers, latest computing tools, software, nonlinear modeling and analysis is becoming a routine thing nowadays worldwide. So I think we should yeah. also embrace all of these fruits of new technologies and I think go to adopt that technology.
But sir, my question is that if it is made mandatory, for example, let's say for the sake of argument, the PBDs made a recommended solution. Mm-hmm. All right. At the end of the day, majority of the companies, at least in Pakistan, majority of the consultancy firm won't be able to afford such a higher end PCs. What do you think about this? And if you talk about the wind tunnel testing, it also takes a huge amount of money. Wind tunnel test.
I understand that because I have performed it for several buildings and it It takes a lot of resources, but I don't think it is going to get to be mandatory. Even in the developed world, it is not mandatory. It is an optional or alternate design procedure for engineers who know more than what a typical code engineer knows. So it will always be an option, a very good option for going beyond the code.
All right, thank you.
Another question is, why are limitation for current code, PCB 2007 PBD? Basically, we don't have that escape clause in PBD in BCP 2007, which allows the use of alternate procedures. Now we are going to have in next version of our building code that allowance for PBD. So the engineers will be encouraged to use that if they can do. So the next version is going to have that, basically to lift that limitation. Similarly, okay, Yasir Mahmood already done. Another question from Muhammad Jaman. For reducing time, can we exclude secondary model? Only critical members are analyzed. I mean, no, this classification of critical and secondary is not based on the participation of their stiffness in the global structural stiffness. This is done to assign the acceptance criteria. For critical elements, we assign a very strict acceptance criteria. For secondary elements, we apply a little lenient criteria. So I don't think this will be a right idea to only model critical elements and just leave the other elements for MC level evaluation. We have to have a detailed, sophisticated nonlinear model to accurately capture all important modes of nonlinearity or failure if we want to capture that. So think of this PBD as a technology which you should embrace openly, wholeheartedly. You have to come out of your comfort zones in order to adopt it or learn it. So I encourage local design offices to just think about their training their next generation of structural engineers in this design approach. This is going to give a lot of benefits in future. Another question from Yasir Mahmood, sir, can we perform typical design using one code and PBD follow a performance-based code? Basically, there is no performance-based code nowadays. There is a performance-oriented code. Performance-based ideology is developed as a reaction against the prescribed cookbook type design procedures. So all the guidelines, they are not having some legal jurisdiction. They are only guidelines available to guide you how to do that PBD methodology. So yes, you can perform the typical design, the code-based design according to different code, pass all that checks and requirements, and then do its performance evaluation. The idea is that your design decision making should be based on performance and not on a particular code. In doing so, if you conform with a particular building code, you can do that. You are allowed to do that. In fact, this is the standard practice, that you start with a code-based design and then you extend that procedure to PBD. You check whether that design, that final design, explicitly conforms to the performance requirements set by the owner or not. If it conforms, it's okay. If it doesn't, you can change that design always. So, if there is any other question, you may please write, or you can just turn on your mic and I'll be happy to answer.
Assalamu alaikum, doctor. Thank you for your presentation. Mere kuch sawal bhi hai, kuch comments bhi hai, sorry. क्या हम जो आपकी जो हमने प्रेजेंटेशन से मुझे समझ आई, जैसे आपने कहा कि जी हम जो अर्थक्वेक आया था, जैसे 2005 का, आप कह रहे थे कि बेसिकली वो जो रेंज थी, मतलब जो हमारा रिस्पांस स्पेक्ट्रम है, उससे मतलब जो 1 सेकंड और 2 सेकंड के दरमियान, इसका मतलब है जो अगर हाई रिस्क बिल्डिंग करना कर रहे हैं डिजाइन, लाइक 20 स्टोरी या 30 स्टोरी या वो सारी बिल्डिंग, सारी बात है एम्पलीफिकेशन तो डेफिनेटली उसमें आ रही होगी, और मे बी वो हम इफेक्ट उसका कैप्चर सही तरह नहीं कर रहे, तो क्या मैं मतलब इस चीज को इंटरप्रेट सही कर रहा हूँ जो आपकी जो प्रेजेंटेशन थी जो आप उसको पॉइंट को हाईलाइट कर रहे थे? एक क्वेश्चन एक तो ये है.
थैंक यू अदनान साहब. ताहिर साहब प्लीज अलाउ मी टू आंसर इट इन उर्दू बिकॉज़ द क्वेश्चन वाज इन उर्दू.
डॉक्टर
आप सही कह रहे हैं.
I am sorry, we have viewers on Facebook right. from other countries. Okay. They won't be able to understand. If you will answer in English, they will know what was the question also. Right. So please, thank you.
So you are right in this understanding that the actual spectrum is two times higher than the standard design spectrum prescribed in Building Code of Pakistan, which means that if I have a 20-story building in Abbottabad, and I use the code spectrum for design of that building, and tomorrow the same earthquake, which is Kashmir 2005, occurs, unfortunately, God forbid, your building is going to experience two times more spectral accelerations compared to what you used in design of that building. All the story displacement, interstory drifts, story shear, story moment, overturning moment, rotations, every demand quantity will be twice as much as what was considered in the design. So now you will be completely relying on building overstrength and inherent ductility, if any. So you are right in that understanding that if you don't consider that local amplification at that particular site, you are wrong by a factor of two already in seismic input. So imagine 25 story, 30 story building being constructed everywhere in Pakistan and without any local soil amplification quantification, without site specific seismic hazard assessment. And we are just relying on traditional building code guidelines. I think any building more than 15 story, it demands that sharpening of the of designer's pencil. It demands that someone should actually quantify all of those inputs, seismic inputs, because I see our structural engineers fighting over different issues like 2% accuracy, 3% accuracy, some factor which is going to govern or not. I mean, you are already wrong by a big margin in seismic input. So it's a kind of a white elephant which you are just allowing it to pass, but you are just focusing on minor issues. So the modeling accuracy is not going to affect that much as compared to the seismic input, which is being kind of going in the analysis model. So this is an important issue. We should address that in near future.
Second question is, Dr. Sir, you are saying that we are going to have changes in our building code of Pakistan in next year. So what kind of the changes, what kind of new things are coming, like you're explaining that like hazard maps are being updated, and what kind of other changes will be added, like two things you have mentioned, like a performance base will be included, and seismic zone map will be updated. So what other kind of changes are being expected in that building code of Pakistan, and how this gonna affect, like you explained that our seismic input that we are doing for our model for our design is barely less than two times. So it means all the buildings that are being designed like 20 story and 15 story, so they need to be retrofitted in the future. So
basically first of all, obviously, as you have mentioned, that the seismic hazard maps are going to be updated, and we already know from different sources there is an overwhelming evidence that the actual level of seismic hazard in the country is almost 1.5 to 2 times higher than what was depicted in the standard zonation map of 2007. We have evidence from Global Seismic Hazard Assessment Program. We have evidence from Global Earthquake Model. And our own local studies, several of them, have indicated that the actual level of seismic hazard is far more than that 2007 map. So one of the major changes would be that the zone-based approach of structural design, which was originally prescribed by UBC 97, is going to get replaced with the spectral acceleration-based seismic design philosophy. And the compatible DBE and MCE level seismic hazard maps will be developed. The spectra, obviously, the shape of that spectra will be will be different. It will be updated based on the IBC philosophy of seismic design. And more importantly, the concept of seismic zones will be replaced by the seismic design categories in conjunction with the IBC 2000 onwards. So there will be several changes, and their implications would be many, by the way. First of all, the use of performance-based design, as you have said, will not be included, but it will be just allowed as an alternate design procedure. So PBD will be just allowed and not included in the building code itself, because the code as a whole will still remain prescriptive. It is defined that way, that it should remain prescriptive, and it should directly give the limits and solutions. But PBD will be just allowed in that, just like any other international building code. And I cannot say much about cost implications, but let me take that opportunity from your question to just highlight here that performance-based design, since it is going to explicitly consider the nonlinear capacity of the structure, therefore, by definition, it is going to be, it is going to propose a more economical design compared to codes. Different building codes, since they account for different phenomena implicitly, whenever a code writer don't understand anything, he gives a coefficient for that, a factor for that. So this is not the way performance-based design works. You have to consider everything explicitly. And therefore, most of the times, performance-based design results in a far more economical design compared to the traditional code-based design. So currently the new code is under process, and different working groups and teams and you can say groups are working on different aspects of that code. It will take its shape in next few months. At that time, I'll be in a better position to compare it with some of the previous sections of our building code. So
thank you.
Okay, I think that maybe one more question from Yasir Mehmood. For the Perform 3D, do we export models from ETABS, or we have ability to model perform typical analysis before carrying out PBD, or we have ability to perform model and perform typical analysis before carrying out the PBD in natively present within the Perform 3D. Perform 3D is specifically for nonlinear analysis. I think you should use ETABS for linear elastic analysis. Yes, you can import your ETABS model to Perform 3D in new ETABS 2019 onwards. 19 is just released, and it has that option to import a model from ETABS to Perform. But I think it is a minor issue. More important is that whether you should adopt that technology as a whole or not. The tools can be different, but the idea should be understood and it should be explained well. So I think we don't have any further questions. So over to you, Tahir Saab.
Thank you very much, Doctor. It was again a very exciting question answer session, very informative. And I hope our audience on Facebook and here have enjoyed the session and will get a lot of benefit from it. So now before we call it a day, let me make few more announcements. Doctor, we have to present you a shield and a certificate that would be sent to you by courier mail by BSC office. Inshallah, that would be dispatched on Monday or Tuesday within this week. Nice. My pleasure, sir. And I would also like to thank all the audience here that they were really good and very pertinent questions were asked. So this is why PSC is getting so much popularity now. I don't know how much it is getting among the domestic audience, but we are getting a lot of attention internationally, as it is evident from Facebook. People are really lauding PSC for conducting such high-level lectures every month. So that is just because of the speakers who come here, talks up like you people, that like you have done today. So I would like to thank all the speakers also who have delivered lectures on from our platform, and that's bringing let's say good name for Pakistan also. Gentlemen, if you see the chat box, the CPD lectures, the CPD certificates can be collected from our office at 32B2 Main Gulberg, and it is from Monday to Friday. Contact person is Ahmed Akram. Telephone number is given, and the days are also given, time when you can collect it. Certificates of this lecture, of this today's lecture, can be collected from Tuesday from the same office, that is 17th November 2020. You people can collect it from there. And next lecture is on 12th December 2020. That would be the last lecture of this year. It will be delivered by Engineer Rizwan Mirza, and the topic is ACI 318, an overview for practicing structural engineers. ACI 318, an overview for practicing structural engineers. It is by Engineer Rizwan Mirza. So that's
sir.
Ji ji.
Sir, aap jo apna address hai, apna office ka, wo Google Map pe update karte hain kindly, aur jo website hai uspe bhi wo aapka update nahi hua, wo address purana address hai. Kindly usko update kar dijiye apni website pe bhi aur Google Map pe.
मैंने वेबसाइट से भी उठाया लेक्चर, ये अपना एड्रेस
सर गूगल मैप पे लोकेशन अपडेट कर दें.
अच्छा वो
लोकेशन
जी सर. साथिया प्लीज नोट इट, ये फौरन कर दें अगर नहीं हुआ तो. बहुत शुक्रिया जी डार साहब, ऐसी इनपुट हमें दिया करें ताकि वी कैन इम्प्रूव आवरसेल्व्स, और बहुत शुक्रिया आपका. ये प्लीज साथिया प्लीज डू इट. ठीक है जी. So, Dr. Saab, I would again like to thank you. Or we also need a support from you in your university. Please convince your colleagues, your students. We have a student associateship also. That is, I think, 250 rupees per year. So please encourage your students also to become the members. We are really trying. For you people, I must give you information that we have already launched our overseas chapter in Saudi Arabia. Mr. Engineer Hamid Ismail there, and he's based in Jeddah. He's taking care of the chapter there. So we people are working very hard. And if there is any publication, if you go to our website, we have a magazine, Civil Engineer. You can give any articles to us also for publishing there. And incidentally, our next speaker, Mr. Engineer Rizwan Mirza, he is the editor of that magazine. So, Dr. Saab, you can please contribute there also. And among the participants who are hearing me, they can also contribute there. We really need people to come forward and give their input for Pakistan Society of Civil Engineers. You are free to make your own committees, start working for PSC. This will really bring good name for our country, Pakistan. You know, just see the history, how American Society of Civil Engineers started. It was just like this. They had a very modest beginning, but now see where they are. So please assist, give your input to Pakistan Society of Civil Engineers. Right. And a last announcement, G, which I have got from the Ministry of Health, they have asked me to request all the participants here and whosoever is listening to me, kindly take care of yourselves. COVID-19 is again coming back, already returned. And please wear the masks when you go out of your house or your office and wash your hands. This is the message which the Ministry of Health has asked me to announce here. So kindly take care of yourselves. It is in your interest that you wear mask and wash your hands regularly. Thank you very much. Stay safe. God bless everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.